Get to the word.
Praise the Lord, briefly. Well, this is the last day of Advent. Well, the last day and the beginning of a whole new changing of the world. So we have what? Prophecy and hope. What's the next shortest candle? Okay, over here would be peace. And joy and love. Boy, this is love. These guys talked forever, didn't they? Look at that. Hallelujah. And today, Christmas Day. The birth. Am I hitting it? Should I put a trick candle in here or what? Praise the Lord. So this is Advent. This is what we're celebrating, is the birth of Christ. Amen. And in that celebration, the evergreen. Evergreens are noted for being what? Everlasting, all year long, right? And the circle is what? Eternal. Eternal. And Advent means forthcoming, the forthcoming, leading up to hope, peace, joy, love. It's all Jesus. And I'm just going to, I've got a brief message here. The Lord was giving me two or three times different things. I was into the Word last night, and then I had some good stuff going on. All of a sudden I see, the heck, somebody's knocking on the door. I'm reading the word, and there's, I looked, it scared me. It was Jason. We had good conversation, then I got turned into a different direction. So I'm putting it all together, praise the Lord, in different places, but praise God. But it's not a long message, it's a short one, but it's about what is Christmas. What is Christmas? There's a lot of time, you know, every year, since I became a believer, each year I've grown into more understanding on Christmas and the whole aspect of Christmas, you know, and how the world sees it, and a lot of Christians, and how true believers see it in the love of Christ. And there's a difference. There really is. And I'm going to start off with Romans 5:8. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So I'm bringing this scripture up today because you know what? Jesus was born. The whole purpose of Jesus being born was to what? To die. Jesus was born to die. We were originally born to have eternal life. Amen? We were born to live forever. But in our sin, took that away. Our sin separated us from God. So Jesus is born to die in order to reconcile us so that we can live forever with God again. That is the purpose. That is the purpose of the king coming here on earth. He came here, he invaded earth. He invaded earth. And through that, through this scripture, through this word in Romans 5:8, we can look at Advent in that forthcoming and understand what that means to have that hope, have that peace, have that joy, and have that love. We can't look at it from any other way, because if we look at it from any other way, the devil's involved. Your flesh is involved. I promised myself I wasn't going on too many rabbit trails today, but I'm already heading in one, so I better reel myself back in, and this is going to go a while. So in saying that, we're not going to understand what our true meaning is. Our true meaning is Christ, Jesus came on this earth to die. That was his whole purpose, to die. He was born today to die so that we could have everlasting life again. Because we had it, we lost it because of what we are. We're sinners. Saved by faith, right? And was it Haley that had the scripture? Jesus didn't come to condemn the world. He came to save it. Amen? He came to save it. Thank you, Jesus. So in saying that, I want to go to Matthew chapter 2. And I'll look at verses 1 through 6. Now it says here that now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and we have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. So me and Tom, we've still been texting together every day. We keep up with Proverbs every morning when we're in prayer, and he gives me the proverb for the day for him, and we give a little blessing to each other. And that one day it spoke to me. It says, you know what? As I was sending a message back to him, it just came. We need to be as wise as the wise men. We need to be as wise as the wise men. You look at this scripture here, it says, they've come to see the king. These guys come from nowhere to see the king. And here they are right in Jerusalem. It says here, what? They were troubled. King Herod was troubled, and so was everybody else, because they didn't understand what the heck they were talking about. They were missing it. They were missing it. They weren't seeing it for what it was. Even though they brought up the prophecy of Micah 5:2, right? Micah prophesied that scripture 700 years prior. 700 years prior, Micah's talking about this, probably not having a clue what he's talking about. He's just going on. Amen. And here it is fulfilled 700 years later. And they're troubled by it. They're troubled. There's a confusion. They didn't know. They didn't know. They didn't understand. Just like many of us today. We're troubled and we don't understand what Christmas is about. What is Christmas? Well, as I look around and I see everybody gets moved out of position because of family, because of kids, because of parents, because of emotions, because of feelings. We get moved in every direction because of worldly influences, which have nothing to do with Christmas. It has nothing to do with it. And I see that, and I was moved in that myself. In my younger years, I always wanted to do was open toys, open gifts. In my pre-adolescent years, leading into my adolescent years, all I wanted to do was get high. Then I come from a big family. Russell was talking about. Then it was the time where I was the life of the party. But then, boom, I got hit. My life changed. And me and Victoria went to one of those parties and it was like, I can't be here. I gotta leave. Everybody wants me to be something I'm not anymore. Because I started seeing Christmas for what it was. There are so many things we can look at in the Word of God that He teaches us to understand this. And to know that, to know, to understand, to know. The word know comes from the Greek word epignosis. Epignosis. E-P-I-G-N-O-S-I-S. Epignosis comes from two different Greek words. Epi, which means super, huge, understanding. And gnosis means knowledge. Knowledge. In many parts of the Bible, it speaks of epignosis. And this epignosis is not something that we're going to understand. And why is that? Because it goes beyond understanding. Let's put it this way. Gnosis. And the word gnosis would be compared to, like, everybody knows who the president is, Obama. Anyone can talk about it all day long about Obama. Oh, yeah, he's the president. Yep, yep. But the epignosis, not many of us understand. Why? Because we're not with him. We're not with him day in and day out. You don't know him. You don't know him from that super understanding, super knowledge. And it's the epignosis that the Bible tells us that we have to understand on who God is. There couldn't have been a better definition of that than what I heard from Larry today. Amen. The epignosis was pouring out because there's gratefulness. Gratefulness about what? The only gratefulness was there about Jesus Christ. Because that's all that matters. We put all the other things into it, and that's great, but it's all about Jesus. You understand? That's what Christmas is about. That's what Christmas is about. All the other things are a byproduct of that. Of that. And here the wise men knew that, but the people in Jerusalem were troubled because they didn't catch on. They weren't seeing it for what it really was. They didn't have that epignosis, understanding, and knowledge to see it for what it was. You understand? And that's what we all need. We need to get that. Because when you get that, you're not going to let feelings bother you on days like this. I mean, I look out in the world, and I've said this before around the table. This is big-time suicide rate. Christmas, what happens? You're moving in your feelings, you're moving in your emotions, you're moving in the way things used to be, and you're in the past, and you're over here, you're over there, you're all over the place, except for you should be, and that is in the love of Christ. Amen. Because it's His day, not yours. It's His birthday. This may not be the exact day He was born, but this is the day we celebrate His birth. So in saying that, let's go to Luke chapter 2. The Christmas story. We all know the Christmas story, but are we living it? That's the question we got to ask ourselves. In chapter 2, I want to start at verse 25 and go to 32. Okay, so now here's Simeon. I'll just read it. Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. So there's this man named Simeon. And this man, there's a man, was a just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. Funny how the Holy Spirit was upon him. This is before Jesus was born, or when Jesus was born. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Praise God. Praise God. So see the difference of the epignosis? Here wise men come out of nowhere to see and all of Israel is troubled. Here they take Jesus into the temple and this priest sees Jesus, and it's epignosis, knowledge comes right to him. He's basically saying here, depart in peace means now I can die in peace. The NLT version says, now I can die in peace. For I have seen the Christ. I have seen the Savior. Well, he's got a little baby in his hand. Amen? Amen. So when he says, I can see, the word see here comes from two different Greek words. Blepo, B-L-E-P-O, and horeo, H-O-R-A-O. Now, blepo is I see, you can see with your eyes what's right in front of you. You can see the baby. You can see the manger. You can see the priest. You can see Joseph and Mary. You can see everything that's around you. But the horeo is the insight. It's the deep insight understanding of what he's actually seeing. We're never going to understand the real meaning of Christmas unless we can get into the horeo of understanding with an epignosis of understanding on what Christmas is really all about. How do we see it? How do we see Christmas? I see it with family, eating, having fun, opening presents, doing this and doing that. What happens if that's all taken away? What happens if that's all gone? In a lot of cases it is, isn't it? So what happens if it's gone? Are you still celebrating the Christmas that God wants you to celebrate? Because it's not about you and it's not about those things that were around you. I hope you can understand what I'm trying to bring across here. He said he's seen. He saw from the horeo aspect, deeply insight of the epignosis of understanding, that he saw a Savior in that little baby. That baby that's been prophesied over and over and over in prophecy and hope, right? He's coming and here he is. Boom, there he is. He's born. And those who are able to see will see. Those who are able to hear will hear. And those who are able to know will know. Horeho is to see the insight. To hear is to hear what? The word of God. Faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God. His word was spoken. The prophet speaks it. They spoke it in front of everybody and they still were troubled. I'm going to tell you right now, and probably 80% of the churches here in the United States and Canada, they're in the church today not having a clue what they're in there for. Oh yeah, they know Jesus. They know Jesus. From what? Agnosis, right? Gnosis. Not epignosis, from gnosis. I know there's a Jesus. I knew there was a Jesus before I was saved. Matter of fact, I was thinking I was saved when I wasn't saved. But when it really happens, it happens. And that changes everything. It should change everything. Doesn't mean we become holy overnight. But you know what? That's where you want to go and that's where your focus is. To continue to build precept upon precept to get to that place. But we're not going to get there if we don't understand it. If we don't see things for what they really are. It troubles me, not because I don't know who he is. It troubles me because I look around people and see that they don't know who he is. And in that trouble comes compassion, because God gives me compassion to show love to try to help people understand that. It's beyond the gnosis. It's the epignosis, the super knowledge that Paul and Peter and everybody spoke of after Jesus ascended into heaven and the Holy Spirit came down to us. The Holy Spirit was with Simeon. God put the Holy Spirit on people throughout the Old Testament. In and out, gone. But now it's given to all of us for all time. Through Jesus Christ. To give us that understanding. Simeon saw the Savior. He saw the Savior. Looking at a little baby. He saw the Savior, just like the wise man did. The wise men with wisdom came and they knew what they were coming to look for. The king. The king. Not the king that Jerusalem was waiting for. They're waiting for someone to come like David to help them defeat the Roman Empire. Didn't say that anywhere in word. They perceive that on themselves, right? Just like we perceive Christmas on ourselves. We look at it the way we want to look at it, the way the world's taken us to look at it. It's a celebration. God has shown us throughout the whole Bible, he wants us to celebrate. But what does he want to celebrate? He wants us to celebrate all his glory. All the festivals that the Jews celebrated. God gave them festival, festival after festival. Those parties lasted a week long. But those parties were to what? To give God glory. To thank God. Not to forget. Not to forget. That's why he tells us these things. He gives us these things so we don't forget. So the devil doesn't pull us away from truth. From truth. How do we know this? From the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is given to each one of us. If you truly believe, the Holy Spirit's with you. Do you believe? If you believe, the Holy Spirit's with you. Do we seek the wisdom, the knowledge, the understanding from the Holy Spirit? Or do we seek it from our own head? That's the difference between being troubled and understanding. It's a fine line between heaven and hell. Heart, head. Praise the Lord. So I stand here today, you know, with the epignosis understanding and the super knowledge that you guys have, that you can see things beyond what they really are. I look at you, I look at everybody. What do I see here? Do we see people? Or do we see royal priests? Do we see people? Or do we see royal priests? I see royal priests. Bible says we are all royal priests. Amen? Amen? In communion, when Pastor Richard's given communion, what do you see? Do you see forgiveness for our sins? Do you see forgiveness for your sins? Do you believe that there's a forgiveness for your sins? Well, then don't let condemnation come back on you because it's gone. It's gone. What else do you see? Do you see healing in communion? I see healing. I see healing in communion. And I see oneness with Jesus. I see oneness in Jesus. These are the things that we should see, right? We should be looking at into with that insight, that understanding. God has fulfilled all his promises in that forthcoming, in this Advent that we're celebrating. He's fulfilled all those promises to me and you. To me and you. We just have to believe. You got to believe. And when you believe, you live it. You just don't say it. You do it. You believe. Hope. Prophecy. Comes from what? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives me the expectations of knowing who Jesus is. I wait on the Lord, my soul waits. In his word I do hope. I wait for the Lord from his word. Like the sun coming up in the morning. Like the sun coming up in the morning. You know it's coming. If you're sitting there for a sunrise, you know it's coming. You don't see it yet. Sky's breaking a little bit. It's getting brighter. You know for sure you know the sun is coming up. That's the expectation you got. You got to know that the Son of God is coming up. And you know that sun is rising. And we're going to have light. We're going to have daylight. That comes in the prophecy and hope of understanding and who he is and who we're not. The joy. The joy comes from what? Salvation. Through him, I'm reconciled back to God. Praise the Lord. Through Jesus, I'm reconciled back to God. I have a joy of understanding that. I have a joy that God is hearing me. That Jesus came for no other reason than to die so that who I was born to live forever am going to die, but now has given me eternal life. So that's salvation. He's saved me. He's brought me back in an insight and understanding, and I can speak to God again and have relationship with Him. Me and you have that. That should be joy. That's the inner joy that's inside of us that nobody can take away. And the peace. The peace. We can live forever. That's why Simeon said, now I can die in peace. I can die in peace. Why? God said he wasn't going to die until he seen the Messiah. He saw the Messiah and his words were, now I can die in peace. He can die in peace because he has eternal life. He knew it. The Savior was there for the world. He's here. John 14, 27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. No fear. No fear. It was spoken there. God doesn't give us a spirit of fear, but of what? Of power, in the name of Jesus Christ. Of love, only through Jesus, which gives us a sound mind, gives us a settling. That now I can die in peace. To live is Christ, to die is gain. I can say that without any fear. Because I know where I'm going. We all got to know where we're going. And I know we know, but the more we know, the more we're going to have epignosis understanding of a relationship with where we're going, with who we're going to see. You can't have the peace of God if you're not yet at peace with God. And that's the struggle a lot of us have. We're still battling. We're battling. God doesn't want us to battle anymore. The war is over. The victory is ours. He struck his heel, but he crushed his head. We have victory. And the last one, the one that is the most feared weapon by the enemy, is love. Is love. The devil hates love. He hates true love. Not love with selfish ambitions and deceptions, because he's moving in that. True love comes from God and God only. And when that love gets put upon us with that epignosis understanding and the horeo insight of that, nobody can steal that. You're going to have hope. You're going to have peace. You're going to have joy because you understand God's love for you. He loves you more than anything that ever will love you. And some. And that was all because he came into the earth today, at least the day we celebrate today. It's his day. It's his day. And the last scripture is Luke chapter 2, verses 13 through 16. Honey, if you put up the NLT version on that one. I promised to be short, so I am cutting it. Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. Praise the Lord. Can you go to the next one? 17. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. So they seen it for what they saw. They saw the inside of the baby. They understood what that was, what baby Jesus was. And what was the next thing they did? They went out to tell others. And that's what we're called to do. If it's truly in you, it's in here, we're going to want to tell others. Amen. Tell others the truth. The truth. That the Savior was born to save me and you from ourselves. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Let's pray. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jesus. Happy birthday to you and many more. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for your Son. Lord, we celebrate today, Lord, and the only reason why we can celebrate is for Him. It's for Him. So we praise you for that, Father God. We lift up the rest of this day, Lord, that we could fellowship together in your love, Father. Let the rest of the day bring glory to you, Father. And Lord, we bless that food that was prepared for our body's nourishment, Lord. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.